How can a perennial wildflower that many of us have in our gardens be considered rare? And what do massive blocks of river ice have to do with it? We're gonna find out on the next Plants Are Cool Too.
Animals are cuddly, animals are cute. You could put a kitten in a three-piece suit. But could an animal make its own food? Could an animal feed the whole world? Could an animal help you get a girl? Plants are cool too. Plants are cool too. Plants are cool too.
It's an early, misty morning in western Pennsylvania as we head out on the Allegheny River, a 325-mile river course whose waters go on to join the Ohio River and, eventually, the mighty Mississippi. Somewhere downstream, we intend to find graduate student Cheyenne More, along with her collaborator, Scott Schuette, who's out here looking to learn more about one of the coolest imperiled plants in the state and the unusual riverside habitat it grows in. A research project stemming from her lifelong love of science and green things.
I always knew I wanted to be a scientist, but I had a position working outside in college and I really enjoyed it. And I wanted to be outside and I wanted to learn more about the plants because plants tell us a lot of cool things and they're often overlooked. And so that was really important to me, to look at something that was really cool in the environment that people don't really pay attention to, but we can learn a lot from.
It wasn't long before my son Jackson and I tracked down their kayak, pulled up on a gravelly island, one of about a half dozen similar habitats Cheyenne was planning to survey on that day. We'd learn soon enough that these particular formations are called scour prairies, and they harbor some pretty fantastic plants.
Hey, Cheyenne, good to catch up with you.
Hey.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
Awesome. So you seem to have found some pretty cool plants.
I have.
Yeah, what are you doing out here?
So I'm looking at this plant, Baptisia australis, or blue false indigo.
Okay.
Which is a state threatened species.
Yeah.
And so I'm out here seeing where it is along the Allegheny River.
People might actually have this plant in their garden. So why are we calling it rare out here in the wild?
So in Pennsylvania, it's considered state threatened because in Pennsylvania, it's only really found along riverways because it's in these communities called scour prairies, which are facilitated by ice scour along waterways, where anywhere else you might find it in a prairie in the Midwest or something like that.
So it's more common to the west of us, but what are we here, like on the eastern edge of its range?
We're on the northeastern edge of the species range.
The species only occurs in these unusual scour prairie habitats.
Essentially, yeah. It's only along four waterways.
All right, so tell me about this. How does ice scour work? Where does it come from?
Whenever ice forms in the wintertime along these big rivers, it eventually breaks up and those big sheets of ice that are broken up come along the riverbanks and basically scrape the banks enough that it reduces trees and things that might shade these individuals out, and it allows them to continue growing with other prairie species like big bluestem and Indian grass.
In regular prairies out west, what does the same thing that ice scour does in these?
So it could be fire or mowing in like facilitated, recreated prairie, things like that.
And in the absence of those things, here in the Allegheny River, it's big chunks of ice in the spring thaw?
Yep.
Yeah, that's incredible.
Over much of its natural distribution, Baptisia australis occurs in prairies and other similarly open habitats maintained by natural disturbance. But out here on the very edge of this range, the closest approximation to that are these scour prairies, openings not created by something like fire, but rather by the violent movement of massive chunks of ice during the annual spring thaw. As the flowing river pulls loads of ice downstream, low-lying banks and islands get torn up just enough to keep Baptisia and its disturbance-adapted associates in business and free from competition from species that can't hack it.
This Baptisia seems to be declining, as do scour prairies. So is that because ice scour as a thing is also starting to happen less frequently?
So it's really important for clearing the land. So you can see there's some sycamore trees around here, and if there's no ice scour, then those are allowed to grow a little bit bigger and shade out the plant. But we're seeing a decrease in ice scour, the frequency and how big the pieces of ice are because of climate change. Also, damming can also be a factor in that as well. That's something that we think is happening in Ohio, and that's part of the reason the populations aren't there.
It's kind of wild, right? So if the river doesn't freeze, and if this habitat doesn't get like crushed by big chunks of ice, that's bad for this plant.
It's very bad for this plant, yes.
If these ice scour communities and all the species that live in them were to vanish, why would that be important? Why should we care about these places?
It's a really unique ecosystem to Pennsylvania. So like I said, it's a prairie, essentially. A lot of the species here are prairie species. And so it's really cool to have a prairie along a river in Pennsylvania. But also a lot of these species are at the edge of their range, which means they either have low genetic diversity or maybe they harbor certain genes that other populations don't have. So genetically, they could also be really valuable as well.
So saving these species on the edge here in Pennsylvania is not just important to Pennsylvania plants, but to all of these cool prairie plants across their distributions.
Definitely.
Concerns about the genetic health of Baptisia australis in Pennsylvania stem largely from the fact that this plant is known to have declined in this region over the last several decades, including its total disappearance from Ohio. The most northeastern remnants of the species now consist of perhaps 20 populations on just 4 western Pennsylvania waterways, Red Bank Creek, plus the Allegheny, Clarion, and Youghiogheny Rivers.
Today, out here in the field, what are the things that you're doing as a scientist?
So the main thing I'm doing is collecting tissue samples from these plants. So one leaf or 3 of these little leaflets, and I'm drying them on silica to use for DNA extraction later in the lab. Yeah. But I'm also looking at the other plants around to try to understand other threats to the conservation of the species. So something we're noticing a lot in these habitats is Japanese knotweed and phalaris, which are invasive species, which can threaten the habitat of the species that we're looking at. So,
okay. So it's full-on monitoring, collecting of material due to genetics with, and then we'll know a little bit more about the status of the species in the state of Pennsylvania.
That's the hope.
But it's not just hope, because this is science, and Cheyenne is also viewing the populations she studies in the field through the lens of some cutting-edge genetic methods.
The big question for me is into the genetics of the plant. So we're using population genetics to better understand what's happening with these plants in the state of Pennsylvania. So are there multiple populations genetically, or is it one big population genetically? How should we be considering them as far as conservation status?
So which of those outcomes, the bunch of small populations or one large population, mean the species is more at risk in Pennsylvania?
So if we have lots of distinct populations throughout the state, so maybe each waterway there's a distinct genetic population, mm-hmm. then that would be of greater concern, and we would want to protect those specific populations more.
Yeah.
So when I get sequence data back, I think that we'll be able to tell that there are several genetic populations, several separate genetic populations in the state of Pennsylvania, so 2 or 3. Which will help us better conserve the populations, because then we'll be able to better understand that they are different things and they're special, and so we should protect each one individually.
Cheyenne's intuition was right. Her results show that each waterway in Pennsylvania where Baptisia australis occurs harbors a genetically distinct population of plants, and each of these populations likely harbors unique genetic diversity that warrants conservation. The most distinct of all the populations on the Youghiogheny River currently consists of only 11 plants, making it a critical target for protection if the goal is to preserve genetic diversity within the state. Facilitating gene flow among all of these populations of Baptisia is among several recommendations that Cheyenne is now passing on to local conservation partners like the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources and the Natural Heritage Program.
I chose this project because it had a real-life conservation application. I really wanted to be involved in something that focused on the health of plants in Pennsylvania. I'm from Pennsylvania. I care about the plants here. And I think protecting the plants that we have and having people know about the plants that we have that are special is really important.
The road ahead, it twists and turns, and the sun beats down and it burns. But I keep on pushing through.
And while caring for special plants sometimes means bearing witness as they decline, on that day in the field with Cheyenne as we paddled the remaining 5 miles of our trip, the story was different. We pulled up to a couple of unexpected scour sites that looked like ideal habitat for Baptisia, and there they were, new populations that no one had recorded before. A chance to add some new dots to the map for a change.
It was really cool to find new places. That's always really exciting because, you know, those are spots that we didn't know existed before. And so now we can keep track of them and monitor the populations, make sure we know if they're healthy. And it's I think it's just really exciting to see that the populations are in places that we didn't know they were, and maybe they're a little healthier than we thought.
So yeah, there still is a lot of hope involved in conserving rare species. Cheyenne's project has mobilized some of that hope, paired it with rigorous field and lab work, and generated tools that other people who care will now use to protect Baptisia australis, the blue false indigo, and the special habitats where it's found. So thanks to all who care, and thanks for watching. Plants are cool too. Yeah, I get up and I'm